Labor MP Louisa Wall has had an extraordinary life. Before being elected to Parliament, she was a black fern and a silver fern. As a List MP and then the member for Manurewa, she achieved significant legislative changes, including marriage equality. But it's a complicated legacy. Louisa Wall has found herself on the outer with members of her own party. She was never made a minister, and in 2020 she was sensationally deselected by Labor in Manurewa. Louisa Wall is leaving Parliament for a new role. Late this week, she and I sat down at her home in Manurewa.
We're sitting here, April 2022, more than a decade since you first set foot in Parliament. As of today, New Zealanders can marry whomever they love. People are better protected from revenge porn and female genital mutilation. They can access abortions via safe zones. Their names can be recorded on their children's birth certificates, even if they're deceased. And that's you. That is all you.
That's democracy, Jack, and that's also Parliament. And I've had the incredible privilege of serving the people of New Zealand in our Parliament.
Let me ask then, what is it that makes you, objectively, so much more effective than the majority of your colleagues in achieving legislative change?
Very much about my personality, but also I think about how I see my role. And I decided pretty early on that if I was in a privileged position to sit in Parliament to make laws to better people's lives, then obviously then I needed law reform, and I needed to be championing different pieces of law reform based on the different mandates that I had. And so marriage equality, for example, came because I was the chair of Labor's Rainbow Caucus. And as the chair, I took on relationship equality, and that meant being the champion for the marriage equality legislation. So many of the law reforms I've proposed have come through either the mandate of my party, the mandate that I had within Parliament. I was the, you know, co-chair of the Commonwealth Women Parliamentarians for nearly 8 years, and that is how we got FGM, or female genital mutilation, change. And then the mandate from the people of Manurewa. So I think I've just picked up the ball and run with it, actually, Jack, and kept very focused on the goal line and scoring tries.
Is there one moment, one little instance from your time in Parliament that really stands out as a particular highlight from your career?
I do have to say that the Paige Harris birth registration bill had tugged at my heart in ways that meant I had to do everything I could to help this little girl and her husband and the family, and actually remembering the legacy of Catherine. And when I heard the story and I realised that there was something that could be done in spite of others having said that they couldn't help them, I just then very systematically went about following the standing orders, and always with the consent of the family. And a lot of the times the family have to give you quite vulnerable information for you to be able to then progress their need and change the law, or to find a solution that has now meant that, yes, Paige Harris, her mum Catherine Harris, is on her birth certificate. So I think that does probably speak to how I see my role, which is very solution focused. And as I said before, you'd find ways to help people, because we're in very privileged positions, we have a lot of power, we have an ability to help, and I think that is my job, to help.
Why do you think you're not a minister?
I'm not a minister because the Prime Minister told me I would never be in her cabinet. And that was her decision, obviously, and I accepted that decision and then just got on with the job. There's a lot of other work to do in Parliament, Jack, to chair select committees, to be the co-chair of the Commonwealth Women Parliamentarians. I'm currently chair of the IPU. So in spite of her not wanting me in her cabinet, it didn't mean that there wasn't other ways, I guess, to contribute and to be an effective member of Parliament.
Why didn't she want you in her cabinet?
Well, see, I can't answer that question.
Why do you believe that she didn't want you in her cabinet?
I think that it probably did go back to, I guess, the open contests that we've had in the Labor Party for leadership over the years, and the time when she ran with Grant Robertson specifically. I supported David Cunliffe. He was the man who I decided had the skills to be the leader of the Labor caucus and take us to, you know, the election, and I think that probably meant for them I was never part of their specific team, even though I was part of and am part of the Labor team. That really, for me, can be the only explanation, that there are teams within teams, and I wasn't in the team that they ultimately decided would be the ones who sat around the cabinet table. And you have to accept decisions like that. I have no control over that, other than to continue to do my job to the best of my ability.
I suppose in a sense it goes beyond just cabinet though, and I think of that extraordinary instance last year when speeches were being heard over the zero suicide report in Parliament, and despite all the work that you'd done in that space, your own party blocked you from speaking. And perhaps I'm naive here, it struck me at the time that if the Prime Minister had wanted you to speak, you would have spoken. Outside of the cabinet issue, did you enjoy Jacinda Ardern's full support?
Well, I think they were messages, probably not so subtle, that it wasn't just she didn't want me in her cabinet. She was obviously very clear that she didn't want me in her caucus. And again, Jack, you're going to have to ask her about why she thought that there was no place for someone like me in the Labor Party caucus.
Did you not feel welcome in the caucus?
Oh, that particular lack of recognition of the work that I'd done on behalf of Labor, that hurt because it was so public. But obviously the kaupapa for me was the most important, and I was very grateful to have been given an opportunity to contribute to that debate.
You referenced in your resignation announcement the 2020 deselection in Manurewa. How did that experience affect you?
Profoundly, in a way, because I'm a very principled person. And I do believe in your actions actually undermine your integrity. And I think there were issues in that selection that undermined the integrity of the New Zealand Labor Party. And I think that's sad when we can not adhere to pretty simple doctrines of electoral principles that are quite fundamental to a functioning democracy.
Do you take it personally?
I had to take it personally to a degree because it was about me, and it was about undermining the Labor electorate committee that I'd belonged to at that time over 10 years. I mean, I've been a member of the Labor Party for over 25 years. And the people, the volunteers within our Labor electorate committee, some of them who were there when Roger Douglas was the MP, throughout George Hawkins' tenure, and mine, a woman called Raywin Turner, who's now 82. You know, 40 years of voluntary service, and that didn't count, and they were just erased, basically. And our mandate as a group of people who pay the levy, who deliver those 23,000 pamphlets to households around Manurewa, were just rendered a nullity. And that, for me, is probably the most upsetting, because Raywin essentially had nothing after that in terms of her community work, and I think that's wrong.
In the political commentariat in New Zealand, there are sometimes murmurings or references, never directly attributable to anyone, that suggest you aren't a good team player. That's a line that often comes out. If you looked back honestly over your career, considering Parliament can be an extremely stressful place at the best of times. Have there been occasions when you haven't been a good team player?
I can understand how people in leadership would have thought that I haven't been as responsive to the requests as I could have been. But my rationale always has been to ensure that the legislation I was working on was going to progress to a point where it would be successful. And if we go back to marriage equality, for example, there were some issues about my framing of marriage equality, the fact I didn't leverage off civil unions, and the fact that I reached out across the parliament and was really clear I wanted to work, you know, with others. Because for me, the rainbow community have always been a political football. And I knew that unless I built really strong coalitions across the House, that at the next election we would have, as we saw with Colin Craig and the Conservatives, the rainbow community of football, and there'll be pledges to repeal marriage equality. So it just didn't make sense. Plus, Labor didn't have the numbers. The reality at that time is I needed to work across the parliament. I needed the 27 national votes. I needed ACT. I needed, the Greens have always been there, I have to say.
I have a curious political history question about that time.
Okay.
There was a senior Labor MP who, after you pushed marriage equality, reportedly caught you in a corridor and said, "Who the F do you think you are?" Do you remember that?
Yes, it was actually in my office.
Who was it?
That was Clayton Cosgrove, who came into my office. He heard me being interviewed on Radio New Zealand, and it was about the Labor Party's commitment to relationship equality. And I talked about the decision-making process that MPs would have to go through, that if you're an electorate MP, some of them would consult and they would have to make up their minds, but that it was Labor Party policy. And as a List MP, he was offended that I'd even spoken about how people might vote, and that's what he did. He burst into my room and that's what he spat at me. I mean, I was told by the Chief of Staff at the time that if I didn't do things that the way that they wanted to do, then I was on my own. And I said, okay, I'm on my own. And I was happy to do that, and happy not to have lines and a narrative around leveraging off civil unions, because civil unions was not about fundamental human rights. It wasn't about equality and non-discrimination. And in a lot of ways, it was a cop-out.
Yeah.
All I've ever wanted is equality for LGBTIQ plus New Zealanders. And that is all I will ever fight for. And I will fight for the right to do that in a way that takes the majority of people with us. So in some instances, I didn't take the leadership of my party because I disagreed with how they wanted to play the game. So most people do come in with wanting to progress and become a minister. And the way you do that is obviously to be part of the team, and you think work diligently. And I'm not saying you work under instruction, but you're very much part of a process that hopefully will produce an outcome. And I think for me, as I said before, I didn't go in with an aspiration for a role. I just wanted to use the role I had to make the lives of New Zealanders better. So if that aspect of my attitude is slightly maverick, I'll take that. But I haven't wanted to be a maverick. All I've wanted to do is to be a good representative.
What you're saying is that perhaps too few MPs cast aside personal ambitions and put the kaupapa ahead of the office.
Pretty much, actually. I'm a kaupapa-driven person, Jack. For me, it's all about the kaupapa. If you haven't got the kaupapa, then what is it at the end of the day? Is it self-interest? Well, I'm not interested in self-interest.
I don't know if you're someone who has regrets, but what's top of the list of things left undone in Parliament?
Oh, there's always more to be done, Jack, and I'm leaving two bills on the order paper, actually. One is about the protection of journalist sources, and for me, I think our fourth estate, I think journalism is incredibly important, and we must protect them, therefore we must protect those who give them inside information, whatever you may call it, but for the betterment of and the greater good of society. And I've given that to my colleague Ingrid Leary, who, as a journalist, I think will run with that ball and do a very good job. And I've left an alcohol-related piece of legislation that started at Manurewa Intermediate School. And it really is about empowering communities to take responsibility for how many liquor outlets are in our communities. And unfortunately, within the current law, we've almost created a property right. So if you are an existing licence holder, you can't lose your licence. Mm. You can only modify the conditions around your licence. And I think that's wrong. I think that communities should have an ability to say, we actually don't want you to sell alcohol in our community anymore, and therefore that licence shouldn't be renewed.
You did a lot of work in the China space in recent years. Does New Zealand go too soft on China?
I think New Zealand idealistically entered a trade agreement with China, and from our perspective we thought that it would be mutually beneficial and it would contribute to the democratisation of China. The reality of how China has used entry into a global economy has not been about democracy. You know, for them it has been about manipulating capitalism. They've had slaves. That's what the Uyghur people have been used for, slaves within their economy. So they've been able to undercut in terms of manufacturing. And many of us now are dependent on goods that we buy coming from China. And so we've had divergent kind of values right from the beginning, but we've become incredibly dependent in some sectors on China, and now exporting to China to therefore provide good quality jobs. So the only real antidote is for us to diversify and to obviously seek FTAs with other countries. But it's not that complex with China. I think like many other countries in the world, we are vulnerable because they economically have some levers over us. Mm. And they manipulate and use those for their own ends. And that's not mutually beneficial. And we are going to have to rectify that situation. But we also need to stand up for the Uyghurs, for Indigenous Muslim minorities. We have to stand against forced organ harvesting. We have to stand against, autocracies.
Labor was elected on big promises to fix the housing crisis, improve New Zealanders' mental health, and to lift people out of poverty. I know that those are complex issues. I know we have faced a global pandemic. But when you think about life for New Zealanders today compared to life for New Zealanders 5 years ago, do you think Labor and government has lived up to its promises?
I think Labor and government has tried to live up to its promises. I think we've tried to put into place the architecture for us to be able to measure how good the public system is in delivering all those objectives you've talked about, Jack. I think where we've fallen down, so to speak, has been in the logistics, like how do we actually get this done? But I do have to say, and I'm not trying to make excuses, but the pandemic has been debilitating for many countries. I mean, we've got a jib crisis. You can't build houses without jib. That has got nothing to do with the government. Mm. You know, and so I think there needs to be a fair assessment of what we promised to do and what we've been able to do, but also what we've committed to doing, and I think we're still committed to doing. So we've done a lot of good work. We have. But I can understand the criticism because we're not moving as quickly as some people think we should.
Tell me about the new role.
So the new role is one that will leverage off a lot of the work I've been doing in terms of the empowerment of women and girls, and also representing and advocating for the LGBTIQ plus community. So it's an ambassadorial role based in the Pacific, focused on women's empowerment, women's equality, LGBTQI rights. It'll be slightly challenging because I'm used to using my own voice to kind of advocate for change, but my job is to find the local voices, you know, the women within countries in the Pacific that need to be formally part of their decision making, whether it's advocating for their needs and aspirations or having a formal say in their parliaments or bills before their parliaments. It'll be an interesting role for me. As some people have said, I'm not very diplomatic, but actually I am kaupapa driven and I am all about community, so it'll be a different way of working, but I'm really looking forward to representing New Zealand in a different context.
How many contexts is that now?
Oh, there's a few, but I mean, my life's been about service and I got that from my dad and a lot of my whānau back in Waitahanui, so, you know, I'll keep doing what I'm doing. I mean, if I could wave a magic wand, I'd want homosexual law reform for the world. You know, 70 countries still, half of them are Commonwealth countries. I'd want us to just rid all of our law books of this archaic law that has been a tool of colonisation. So for me, going into the Pacific, I feel that I do have some authenticity. New Zealand is a Pacific country. I'm Indigenous to the Pacific, and I look forward to working with our whānau within Te Moananui a Kiwa to help make the lives of our collective citizens better.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Tēnā koe. Thank you very much for your time.